From Washington, D.C. to the Central Coast, this is Focus with Farr, where our representative in Washington hosts in-depth discussions of important issues of the day. And now, Congressman Sam Farr.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of Focus with Farr. I'm so glad that you are able to join us today. In California, we understand the value of promoting organic farming industry. Fresh produce is not just a necessary ingredient for a healthy body, but also necessary for a healthy economy. There is a discussion going on right now here in Washington about the future of farming in this country. At the U.S. Department of Agriculture, part of that discussion centers on organic farming. But what you may not know is the roots of that discussion stretch all the way back across the country to our home on the Central Coast. What started as an idea in our area has now grown to a national movement. Here to talk about the evolution of organic movement, first at the local level, back in the district, and now at the national level, are my two good friends, Kathleen Merrigan and Mark Lipson. Kathleen is Deputy Secretary of the U.S. Department of Agriculture, a massive responsibility. Working alongside Secretary Tom Vilsack, she oversees the day-to-day operations of many of the USDA programs, including the Know Your Farmer, Know Your Food effort. She was once named by Time Magazine as one of the 100 most influential people in the world. She is a leading supporter of the organic policy movement in Washington, and we are grateful to have her here with us today. Thank you for joining us, Kathleen.
Hey, it's great to be here. We have a lot to talk about.
Yes, and we have Mark with us too. And Mark may look familiar to many of you because he came to Washington from Santa Cruz, a native of Santa Cruz. Mark and I first met when he was a constituent of mine and I was in the California State Legislature. He convinced me to author the California Organic Food Act. And when I was a state assemblyman, we were able to get that passed and signed into law. He was instrumental in the development of the local organic industry through his work at the Organic Farming Research Foundation and as chairman of the California Organic Food Advisory Board. 2 years ago, Mark left his job in Santa Cruz for Washington, D.C. to serve as USDA's Organic and Sustainable Agricultural Policy Advisor. That's a big title. That title is a bit long, so perhaps it's easier if we just call him our organic guru. Does that work for you, Mark?
That'll work okay, Sam.
Well, let's go. You know, this is an exciting moment. We've 10 years since the organic rulemaking was made here in Washington, so we have a celebration at this moment. And perhaps we can talk about how far the industry's come. And I also want to go back to how it all started when Mark petitioned me and we organized in California. But it took, when we enacted the law in 1990, it became law. They didn't have to do a lot of rulemaking because California law is written pretty specifically, and Mark and his team was very good at implementing it. And when we adopted that law, there were things we couldn't do because there was national supremacy, so to speak. The U.S. Department of Agriculture is in charge of all the health safety, food safety for poultry and meat. So we couldn't set our own standards in California, and so we left that in a black hole to wait for the federal law. And we also did that in one other field, and I believe in fish. We now have the standards in law at the federal level and the rules written, and one of your millions of jobs is to make sure that these authorities are implemented in a constructive way. But let's just talk about how far this movement has grown. When I was first coming to Congress, no one ever talked about organic. It was minor crops. And now we've got that term transferred to specialty crops. The only discussion in town was commodity crops, which are, you know, five or six crops of soybeans, wheat, corn, rice, beans, so on. And that's what we grow in the Midwest. But in your opinion, how big is this movement now?
Well, it's very, very big. It's nationwide. It's every crop, every state. And it's very much become institutionalized at USDA, which is certainly something that Mark and I are working on because in the early part of the organic program that we have at USDA, which is basically the standards and making sure those standards are upheld and the certification is done properly, every question about organic went to the National Organic Program. But really, every agency at USDA should have a piece of their work related to the organic industry. If I'm the Farm Service Agency, what am I doing to outreach to get farm operating loans to organic producers? If I'm in the Natural Resources Conservation Service, what practices am I cost-sharing with farmers on their land to help with organic production? If I'm in the Food and Nutrition Service, how am I thinking about partnering in ways that allow organic products to get into our food services that we provide? So we've been hard at work. We have a strategic plan, Mr. Congressman. I know strategic plans generally are not page turners, but one of the things that Secretary Vilsack did early on when we came in the Obama administration is we put together a new strategic plan, new team, new plan. And in our strategic plan, there is a goal that the number of organic operations in this country will increase by 20%.
25.
25. See, I underestimate. 25% by 2015. And so that's a pretty big goal. But this means, when it's in the strategic plan, it means that people really pay attention to it. And all of the people in USDA know that when their performance review time comes up, they are held accountable to what are they doing to move this ball forward. So it's an exciting time for organic.
Well, you've been a wonderful champion, an outspoken person, and obviously a person of national renown. So when you go places, people listen. And I was really interested in attending a conference in Cannery Row at the aquarium. Yeah. And you were the keynote speaker for not farmers, but chefs mm-hmm. from all over the world, and the media, the food media, were all there and very fascinated with what you had to say. What was the theme of that, and why were you asked to speak?
Well, I really love coming out to your district, by the way. It's a beautiful part of the country.
Well, you
not
know,
hard service
you know the
to go
other
there.
Coast from being from Massachusetts.
That's
so
true.
We're coast to coast.
Coast to coast. One of the things I wanted to talk about with the chefs there and with the media is this new effort underway at USDA on Know Your Farmer, Know Your Food. You mentioned it in the introduction. I know you're familiar with it. But what we're trying to do is let the world know that USDA is open for business in ways perhaps never before seen in helping support local and regional agriculture systems. And a lot of that is very pertinent to organic agriculture. There's a lot of overlap there. And so we have this new tool. I'd like to show you a slide really quickly, if I could. It's the Know Your Farmer, Know Your Food Compass. It's on our website. And if you look at the slide here, you'll see a map of the United States with lots and lots of dots on it. If I go in, I hit on any of those dots on this geospatial mapping tool, I can find out in Massachusetts, where I'm from, what we've done with rural development funding, with farmer service agency funding, with resource conservation funding, et cetera. It helps me understand where I can go for money. And you know what? I can look over to Texas and say, hey, they got something that I haven't got yet in Massachusetts. And I can put pressure on the system to get what I need in my home state. And I'd like to show you a second slide here. This is your district. And so we see these dots. They're USDA investment dots. And there's also the little orange ones is farmers markets. And we also have dots, the kind of the pinkish MI one. Those are where you have slaughter capacity. So we're also trying to amass a lot of context data to see how we can grow up local and regional food systems. This compass also has a beautiful narrative with lots of case studies. And in October, this is a 2.0 version. And in October, we're going to put up the 3.0 version. People get very nervous when I make promises about the future. But the 3.0 version, where we will not only have USDA investments on the map, but also other departments of the federal government that are helping facilitate growth in local and organic agriculture, Centers for Disease Control being one of them, Department of Transportation being another. We're going to put their investments on the map as well. It's very exciting.
Well, it is very exciting because what we're trying to do is in all over the country, but in our district, is to grow jobs. Mm-hmm. And this is a growth industry. Organic industry, more than any other part of agriculture, is growing much faster. And because of the nature of it, is, you know, fresh field, fresh to fork, and know your farmer, know your food. What you need, struggling businesses, is always how do I get stronger or bigger? And, you know, this is what I appreciate about you, is asking Mark to come work for you, because when I met Mark, he never had a coat and tie on. Mark wasn't dressed up like a businessman. I think you had coveralls on and a hayseed hat, and you were just, your fingers were in dirt, because you are an organic farmer. Tell me how you got started in Santa Cruz doing organic farming.
Well, I became a member of the Molino Creek Farm Partnership up in Davenport, and right away we started looking at what does organic certification mean, and how do we get recognized for what we're doing in the marketplace. And so that's how I got involved with California Certified Organic Farmers, CCOF, and from there realized that there wasn't very much governance of the term other than the certification organization that the farmers themselves were doing, but we were not able to control what other people were doing in the marketplace.
And that's when you came to me, because they'd had that ALAR scare, and what happened is everybody then started, all the growers, I think in that case it was apples or others, and they just would stamp organic on it because there was no regulation. You could grow it in pure chemicals and say you were organic, and so we needed to standardize and have an enforcement.
The big incident that we had, we called the carrot caper. It was these big 50-pound bags of carrots that were conventionally grown but were being sold as organic, and the San Jose Mercury News, I think, did a expose of that, and that helped stimulate the discussion about needing state legislation. And as we were doing that, we also started talking about things at the federal level, so the revision of the California Organic Foods Act and the Federal Organic Foods Production Act were proceeding along at the same time. We didn't know if either one of them was going to come to fruition or which one would be first, and they ended up completing within about 2 months of each other in 1990.
Now that was amazing. I remember a meeting at UC Santa Cruz at the
Farm Garden
with Alan Cranston, and it was, what is this U.S. Senator doing here on a local issue? And he said, we heard about this. I'm working with Senator Leahy. We're very interested in doing the same thing at the federal level. We've got a bill in, and we want to see what California's doing. And ironically, as you said, they passed just within months of each other and started the entire movement. I mean, this is where it all began. And what is fascinating about you, Mark, is there's not a lot of people that come right out of the fields and end up managing a national, international program. I mean, was it hard to leave the fields to get into the policy making, into the...
You're not going to make him homesick on me. I need him here, please.
Well, I will stipulate for the record that I miss my home a lot in California, but there's plenty of good stuff to do here in Washington, and it's a good time to be here, and we're making great progress at USDA. There's a great team of people there, and what I've been able to do is connect with people throughout the whole Department of Agriculture who have a little bit of organic in their portfolio for whatever they do, whether it's crop insurance or price reporting or conservation programs. Everyone throughout the department is actually really enthusiastic about doing more for organic farmers and helping organic succeed. So it's incredibly rewarding to be here.
Well, it's what for me it's exciting for two reasons. First of all, because I'm so fond of you because of your passion for carrying an idea and then getting in, petitioning your government, listening to what I had to say about here's how you do it, and you going out and organizing people to do it and being successful in your first time around. I mean, I remember when we started that bill in Sacramento, we thought, well, it's going to take several sessions of the legislature, and we got it done in one session. But I grew to admire you because you really got into the law, writing the law. I mean, the words and the administrative side of it. So it's not a lot of people that are in the fields or in of whatever profession that end up being where you are to be able to go from invention to administration. And it is really important because therein is where the credibility is. You know, how do these people, they don't know what it's like to be out doing this. And you do, both of you do. This is why I think this administration is so fortunate to have you in it at a time when agriculture is, I mean, right now we're going through a huge drought and the Congress is panicked about how we're gonna save the Midwest. I know we will, because we have the tools and authorities to do it. Mm-hmm. But on the same hand, it's got internet, and we grow more food than we can consume in the United States. We've got to export it. All the countries we export it to have their own standards. They don't want us to, you know, you did a marvelous job, maybe speak of that for a minute, about sure. how you got the European Union, which has been more difficult on these issues than any other part of the world, mm-hmm. and setting their own standards and saying, United States, if you want to sell in a market, you got to play by our rules. And you use the quid pro quo, well, if you're going to sell into our market, you got to live by our rules, and you worked it out. Can you explain how you did that?
Sure. So we had a great success story. At the beginning of this administration, we enacted an equivalency arrangement with Canada, our neighbor to the north, so that organic can be freely traded.
The equivalency means both sides agree.
We agree that the standards may be slightly different, but essentially they're the same. And we just, this June of 2012, had the same arrangement with the European Union. So this is really, really important if you're a mid-sized company or a smaller company. The big guys, they usually can, they have a lot of staff and they can make their way. But particularly for mid-sized companies who are interested in export, this means you don't have to have duplicative certification and fees. You don't have to have a bunch of lawyers figuring it all out. It means that trade is really open, and I think it's going to be a very big boost for our industry here in the country.
And you're also boosting, and what I'm excited about is you're boosting of getting organic into schools and into restaurants. I mean, the market demand, the niche. I love Nora's restaurant here in Washington. I wish our restaurant association across America would duplicate her menu. Because her menu tells you where every product on that menu comes from. So it gives that know your farmer. Here's a very high class restaurant in Washington, presidents go to, and most of us, you know, the joy to eat there. But it's such a different experience because of the way the food is, the way the menu is laid out. So and you feel like you're eating it right off the farmer's plate, so to speak. That presentation is great. Now you're trying to, I mean, that's just private sector like done. She's got her market niche there. But what about in the public institutions, in schools and hospitals and so on?
We're really pushing farm to school. We have a new grant program that came about from your work in the Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act, and that's going to be great. We'll have some awards later this year. But generally what I see around the country, Sam, is that people want to reconnect with what's going on in our working lands and our farms and ranches. Even if you're never going to be a farmer or rancher yourself, there's this recognition that 99% of us are not on the farm and ranch. And yet we're dependent upon these people and what goes on in the land. And people want to know more. They want to celebrate and honor those farmers and ranchers. And so they're looking to buy local. They're looking to buy organic as a way to support people who are pioneers on the land, and that's very exciting.
I've seen it in our own district. I'm used most of the farmer markets and being able to use the tools, for example, the WIC program, which your department administers, the vouchers that are given to women who are pregnant or have young children to teach them infant feeding, breastfeeding, and other. And then being able to take those vouchers, and what they've done in Watsonville, California, is they literally take a cardboard box from the Department of Social Services, which administers the program, to the farmer's market, and the women who qualify come up and get their vouchers right there and turn around and spend them in the market. And so I asked the vendors, I said, is this voucher stuff significant? He said, oh my God, 65% of my business comes from these vouchers. Yeah. So there really is a positive win-win on both sides because they're buying fresh, organic, and nutritious food, which is why we have the program, and they're buying it from a local vendor.
We've just put out quite a bit of money this summer to try to have every farmer's market in the country be accessible for people who have food stamps as well, the SNAP program. A big chunk of that money went to California, but we're not going to be there at the end of this calendar year that all farmers markets will mm-hmm. have that redemption capacity, but that's the vision.
Mm-hmm.
And we have now over 7,000 farmers markets that we track across the country, and we're hoping that with this new infusion of funding, we'll get nearly two-thirds of them with that electronic benefit transfer capacity.
Terrific, really terrific. Mark, knowing what you know now, if you were starting up or back in your business, what have you learned coming to Washington that could help you or help small farmers or help people in the organic industry? Because you've really had a chance to see it from, as we say, the 30,000 foot level, and you get a much bigger picture and a lot of other tools that are available that you never knew about probably before.
Well, the number one thing is to be involved, you know, to make your voice heard. I think it's hard for people to realize that they actually can have access to the decision making and the decision makers and how policy gets made. But from my experience being here in Washington now working on the inside of that process, I'm surprised every day how much effect that that can have. And
so you think there's not enough, I mean, in order to usually ask because you know there's something to ask for. Do you think that there's, we've done a good job of getting the amount of tools, and you were talking about how the department's plan, strategic plan, requires every department in the USDA to kind of take a look at what they're doing and yep. have an organic
goal and objective
leg to mm-hmm. to their program. And
yeah.
that seems to me, those are things that as I've been exposed to these things for small businesses and stuff like that, I find most people don't know they're out there. Oh my God, that tool's there and I can go ask for it?
Yeah, and it's not only about the specific policy objective that you have at one time, it's about familiarity with who organic farmers are, what they're facing in trying to make their businesses successful. It's that knowledge within the department that only comes from being exposed to people who are out there working the land.
Well, for example,
milking their cows.
You probably know a lot more about financial tools that are available to farmers, having been here.
And sure.
know more about things like marketing tools. If you have, you want to reach out and get your product into a market, there's some, the government does a lot of market surveys and will do market niche advertising and helping you do promotion, we call it market promotion. Those are things that I would think the average small farmer wouldn't know that they could go and get help with.
Right, and so one of the things that we're trying to do is make sure that all the USDA field offices are well equipped to understand what the needs of organic farmers are and direct them to the programs that can help them.
And one of the things, again, to go back to that compass map that I showed you at the beginning, that was one of my initial questions coming into this job. Okay, you get this vast bureaucracy of USDA. I have over 40 programs in my rural development mission area alone, all of which have different definitions of rural. How does someone on the outside possibly navigate?
Yeah.
How do they know? That's why we came up with the compass. It does allow people a huge degree of transparency on how we spend our money. It allows them to see how money can be used. You can search on the word organic. You could search on the word organic in a particular SIP code. So I really want to really want to headline that tool for people because it's something Mark and I have worked really hard on to try to make USDA accessible to the people out in the countryside.
Well, I'd like to congratulate you and Secretary Vilsack for that leadership. My frustration in being in politics is that I learn about all these, you know, 1,000 points of government that are out there. And you wonder, they're all there to help people, but how in the hell can any consumer ever understand that there's 1,000 of them? And how do you bring them to something user-friendly one-stop? I love this idea of the compass because you can go there. We ought to be doing that for Small Business Administration, veterans benefits, for Medicare, and for
all the Social Security for all the aging issues, one stop to give you all of that. The new Obama healthcare plan does something like that. But I think this is the roadmap to the future if we're really going to empower the people to appreciate what their taxes are going for and how those can enable them to help their lives. We're going to have this ability to navigate through all of these bureaucracies. And they're going to be around because there's the other side of the coin is you got to be accountable for the taxpayer dollar. I'm not sure we have to have as many, you know, reorganization is important, mm-hmm. difficult to do, but important. But I think this team building and next team building is probably with state and local government as they understand what they have. Mm-hmm. And, you know, in California, we're the only state that has county ag commissioners who have to do a report on all the crops, the values of the crops and where those crops are sent and all those things. And in Monterey County, we've just done one on the second stage of that. What is the economic value of agriculture in the mm-hmm. in the secondary tertiary markets? And it's about $9 billion. It's huge, just in one county. And you know all the financial institutions and other tractor companies and things like that. Well, we're kind of coming to, this goes fast. This focus so far goes really fast, and I appreciate it. Let me just ask you to kind of, what would be your last word you'd like my constituents to know, Mark's constituents to know about?
Well, I want to thank them for letting me have Mark. and I know his farm's there, and he thinks about it a lot. But with your help, with Mark's help, we're doing a lot of really great things at USDA. So I want people not to be discouraged, take a fresh look at what we're up to, and I think there's a lot of good news, as I said from the very onset.
And you're doing a lot. I mean, we don't have enough time to get into it, but all of this controversy of issues that are like, you know, GMOs and stuff like that. I mean, you have really, you're ahead of the game. You understand that issue.
Well, certainly that issue is front and center at USDA, and we have a team working with the secretary on the AC21 committee, trying to figure out market mechanisms and public policy ways of addressing that issue so that there's a peaceful coexistence among producers regardless of what kind of crop you produce.
Well, I have great confidence in your capabilities of doing so. And Mark, I'd like to thank you for coming from Davenport to Washington, D.C. to help lead the whole organic movement, not only nationally, but internationally. It's great to have you on my show.
Thank you, Sam.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you, sir.
Kathleen, thank you for being here. We're really proud of your leadership. It's nice to have a woman running, being number two at the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
Well, thank you. I look forward to getting back out to your district soon.
All right, we'll do that. Thank you for watching Focus With Farr. We hope you've enjoyed this hour and look forward to having the next program very soon. Thank you for watching.
For more information, contact one of Congressman Farr's district offices. You can also reach Congressman Farr in Washington or visit his website.